We have a great variety of subjects. Our first talk this year is very timely, although perhaps not as timely as it was a couple of weeks ago. Public attention tends to shift. I should understand this better than I do now, and I'm still kind of amazed. As far as I know, the turmoil in Egypt continues. The situation in Egypt hasn't really changed much. Again, as far as I know, right, you can set me straight. But of course, it's been pushed off the front page of the paper by the situation in Syria. Let's go around the room as we always do, and so our guest will know with whom he is speaking. Just go right around, starting with just give your name and your affiliation.
Sarah Parkinson, Global Policy at the Humphrey School, Assistant Professor.
Bobby Sullivan, Humphrey School, Global Policy, Staff.
Jay Kudrowski, Senior Fellow, Humphrey School.
Robert Crosby, I'm the Leadership and Management Faculty at Humphrey.
Dirk Kudrowski, History.
I'm Ryan Allen, I'm on faculty at Humphrey in the Urban Regional Planning.
I'm Greg Lindsay, I'm on faculty at Humphrey.
Deborah Levison, I'm always confused on what part of the faculty I'm on at Humphrey. So.
Greta Friedman Sanchez, faculty at Humphrey in Global Policy.
Basu Alamu, Applied Economics Department.
Tom Anderson, first year MPP.
Chip Peterson, interloper.
I'm retired from the Learning Abroad Center. As I am. No interloper.
I'm retired from the Learning Abroad Center.
Doug Caruso, we're just visiting from Canada. I used to be the city planner for the Civic Windsor.
Ana Maria Caruso, I'm retired from the University of Windsor, Spanish.
Rosa Maria de la Cueva Peterson, concerned citizen.
Peter Schmidt, first semester MPP.
Kasira Absire, first year MPP.
Okay, let's start again then.
Patricia Dorsher, second year MPP.
Shruti, first year MDP.
Lauren Weber, first year MPP.
I'm Bishan from Applied Economics Department.
David Lemon, first year MPPs.
Dave Hollister, School of Social Work.
John Walkley, retired.
Claudia Carlman, Department of Applied Economics.
Brian Atwood, Humphrey, Global Faculty.
And Bob Cooterly from the Humphrey School. Many of you know, I agree he needs no introduction. He's probably the leading expert on Egypt in this area. His early schooling was in Egypt, although his advanced training, university training was in the United States. He was with the Population Council based in Cairo for a number of years. He goes to Egypt often, he has family there, and although he's an expert on the Middle East more broadly, his principal is in fact in Egypt, so it's a delight to have him here today, and he has suggested to me that if people in the question and answer period want to ask about Syria, he's happy to talk to that. But his topic today is a possibly futile attempt to make sense of events in Egypt. I think he wants to lower your expectations, but I'm sure he can make much more sense of it than any of the rest of us. So welcome, Ryan, and thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Bob. Actually, you stole my very first line that I wanted to lower your expectations. So.
Do you want to be interrupted with questions?
Yes, I don't mind at all questions as we go along, and if I think it's going to take us way off track, I'll tell you, you'll wait till the end. So Professor John Bryson walked into my office today pointing out that one of his stakeholder diagrams to understand what's going on in the Middle East. So I thought I'd start with this, but no, I'm not planning to go through this diagram. I'll have a much simpler stakeholder diagram, I hope, in terms of what's going on. So, but this was actually in the Washington Post couple of days ago. So to start, you know, I basically want to tackle the main questions that we're all asking ourselves. The whole world was asking it. What's happening in Egypt the second wave of a revolution, of a popularly supported revolution, or is it a military coup, a sort of counter-revolution that is heralding a return to authoritarianism? And is Egypt, because of that, because of the polarization that's occurring as a result of this most recent development, going to be moving in the direction of Syria, Libya, and Iraq with long-term instability and violence, or is it going to be eventually be able to pursue a more genuine transition to democracy? And then finally, I want to kind of see what the implications of these is to U.S. policy and both towards the Islamic world as a whole and towards Egypt. And in particular, the U.S. saw the Egyptian experiment as being very important to its efforts to convince Islamists around the world that democracy can work for them. And now that this has unraveled, what does that mean for that sort of policy? So let me first, I'm going to spend some time on kind of looking at who the major actors are on the scene and what sorts of alliances have taken place among them. To try and basically just clarify what's going on a little bit, even though maybe I'm going to complicate it, possibly complicate it more than I'm going to clarify it. But before I start with this, I give quite a few lectures on Egypt, and the last time I gave the lecture on Egypt, the Muslim Brotherhood was on the ascendancy. It was the ruling party in Egypt. It had won its most recent confrontation with the military, in fact, when President Morsi was elected in June of 2012, the very first act he did in July, actually early August, was to remove all the top brass of the military who were trying to limit his power, and handpicked a general whom he thought would be friendly to him and would be somebody who was religiously pious and would be friendly to the Muslim Brotherhood, and that's General Sisi, who happened to have ousted him later on. So they also had started to consolidate their power within the Egyptian state apparatus, appointing many governors that were members of the Muslim Brotherhood, a cabinet that was mostly dominated by the Muslim Brotherhood. And they had appeared to be poised the next legislative election, and they were writing the rules in terms of how the elections were going to be carried out. They had passed the constitution against the howls of the opposition and their loud objections. So they seemed to be in a strong position, and they were starting the process of their confrontation with the judiciary, which seemed like the final kind of institutional element of the state that was resisting their onslaught. So let's actually try and look at the various actors. So I'm going to say one of the primary actors on the Egyptian scene is the state itself, or the pre-revolutionary state, which you can think of it as being strongly connected to the authoritarian regime of Mubarak, but I want to argue that parts of it were actually quite relatively autonomous from the Mubarak regime and managed to survive the fall of Mubarak and actually to some extent strengthen. So you have clearly the National Democratic Party, which was the party that Mubarak used as the main tool of his co-optation of the population, was essentially a large network of local leaders and local notables through which the party had its patronage networks. It was also made up of the business cronies, who all the business people who kind of benefited from their association with the regime, and in particular were close to Gamal Mubarak, the son of Hosni Mubarak. So the National Democratic Party collapsed very quickly. But the patronage networks on which it was based remained and still were accessible to some of the elements of what I would refer to as the deep state. So the deep state is this kind of collection of interests within the bureaucracy, the military, and the security forces and other parts of the state that managed to protect or at least maintain its interest even after the revolution. Now, the internal security apparatus, which is basically the police and all the security services that maintained control partly through repression, partly through basically gathering information, etc., that also seemed to be hit a very strong blow by the revolution, and in fact seemed to kind of, if not be disintegrate, but go on strike. They stopped enforcing regulations. Even the traffic police couldn't control traffic anymore. It was just, they simply went home and said, we're not going to work anymore. People don't like us, okay, we're going home. But remained cohesive as an institution, was never dismantled. Now, the state-owned media is one of the easiest institutions in Egypt to take over. Basically, when the Muslim Brotherhood regime came in, they essentially changed all the heads of the government-owned newspapers and radios and TV stations and replaced them with their own people and therefore got the message. However, by then, the state-owned media had already much more limited influence because of the emergence of satellite TVs, satellite channels, private newspapers, and a whole slew of private media, which had, if it had any interest in particular, it had the interest of the secular political parties and the business groups, and so were not under the control of the state. And I'll mention those in a minute. The last two groups here, the military forces, the army in general, and the judiciary, were the ones that were most autonomous from the Mubarak state. Mubarak, despite the fact that he had a military background, always had to keep the military happy. And they did that. He did that through giveaways, through basically a lot of economic benefits and privileges. But the military was always a threat. And in fact, they were particularly unhappy with his plan to basically transmit the presidency to his son, Gamal Mubarak, who was not himself of a military background. And so there was a lot of talk about what would the military do if such a succession plan actually takes place, and at least the rumor mill was talking about a potential coup against Gamal Mubarak if that would actually happen. So there was never, Mubarak could never completely rely on the loyalty of the military, and in fact, when push came to shove, after the 18 days of the revolution, the military did abandon him, but it still sees itself as a very important pillar within that deep state apparatus. And now, the judiciary as well was fairly autonomous. There were parts of the judiciary which were loyal, very loyal to the Mubarak state, and in fact put there by Mubarak, but they were essentially the special courts, the courts that they sent people to when they wanted to get a certain result, and usually that's the emergency rules court, the so-called high security courts, and the military courts. The rest of the judiciary often did not oppose necessarily the Mubarak regime, but was not completely controlled, and in a few instances showed quite a bit of autonomy vis-a-vis the Mubarak regime in terms of for instance, nullifying the parliament a couple of times when the election was considered to be, this is during Mubarak's time, elections considered to be flawed. So the military forces and judiciary are the two parts of this state apparatus which actually survived and in part were strengthened by the revolution by establishing their autonomy from the previous regime. Now, of course, the second bloc is the so-called Islamist bloc. And the Islamist bloc are basically the parties that believe in establishing Islamic law or Sharia law, in having no separation between religion and state, or at least very little separation between religion and state. And they are anchored by the Muslim Brotherhood, which is an 80-year-old organization which developed basically with the vision of recreating the caliphate, which is basically the political leadership across the Islamic world rather than in a particular country. And so this for them is kind of their own. And they initially who are pursuing violent means to do that. But in the 60s and 70s, there were these revisions within their ideology, and they decided that it's primarily through what they call da'wah, which means proselytizing or mission work, that they're going to convert people to their way of thinking, and they're going to work in the grassroots in terms of charitable organizations, etc. Now, the Muslim Brotherhood had already been quite important in 1952, when the monarchy was overthrown in Egypt, and Gamal Abdel Nasser, another military officer, had come to power with what was then a coup, which was often referred to as a revolution, the 1952 revolution in Egypt. And very early on, there was a confrontation between the military under Gamal Abdel Nasser and the Muslim Brotherhood, as they thought they were the ones who actually lay the groundwork for the revolution or for the coup at that point, and then power was grabbed by Nasser. Now, people are now very tempted to make clear analogies between what's happening right now with el-Sisi and the Muslim Brotherhood and with what Gamal Abdel Nasser in 1952-54 did with the Muslim Brotherhood. So in 54, there was an attempted assassination against Nasser, and as a result of that, he came down very hard on the Muslim Brotherhood, pushed them into the underground. They, in 64, attempted another coup against the Nasser regime, and this is where a lot of their leadership was executed by the Nasser regime. So this history of confrontation between the military, the nationalist military, versus the Brotherhood actually dates quite far back. Now, so you have the Muslim Brotherhood as this very well-organized, hierarchical organization. As part as a result of that repression in the 50s and 60s, they formed what is considered to be the secret org. In Arabic, it's called the secret organism, but it's not quite a good translation. So it's kind of the parallel organization that is secret and hierarchical and has an international reach. And then they had their public face, which was the charitable organization that that was providing services. And now it's interesting that the leadership of these two organizations was often different, and different parts of the organization had the ascendancy at different times. But in more recent years, it's the leadership of the more conservative, secret organization that is very militarized internally in terms of its command structures, etc., that had become more ascendant. And so, and they pushed out a lot of the moderates, that including some that I'll talk about in a minute. Now, in addition to the Brotherhood, there is a relative newcomer to the scene of the Islamist politics in Egypt, and those are the so-called ultra-conservative Salafists. Or the Salafists are adherents to a version of Islam that is very close to the Wahhabi Islam of Saudi Arabia. In fact, the origins of the Salafists in Egypt seem to be the migration of Egyptians to Saudi Arabia, and they're basically the influencers. It's the largest, Saudi Arabia is the largest recipient of Egyptian migrants. So millions of people are going there and coming back, and often coming back with these Wahhabi ideas. So their main, they share with the Brotherhood the desire for Sharia law and for Islamic law. However, there's always been a huge rivalry between the Brotherhood and the Saudis about where the leadership of the Islamic world should be. The Saudis are very much against the idea of the caliphate. They want to maintain leadership in the Islamic world as being the custodians of the holy places in Mecca and Medina. And they always felt the Brotherhood as a threat. And so the Salafis and the Brotherhood are uncomfortable allies. While they agree on some things, the Saudi influence on the Salafis is such that they try to keep them quite separate. The Salafis are much more disorganized. They are many, many different parties, many different groups, very conservative, but had not been engaged in politics in a big way before 2011. And they receive huge amounts of money from private foundations in Saudi Arabia and have extensive charitable networks in Egypt, and that's why are very appealing to particularly the poor, in mostly in urban slums, etc. So what's interesting is that when the recent coup happened, well, let me postpone that story a second. The third group is the secular revolutionary bloc. Now, I put together here kind of the liberal secularist parties that were some of them were organized prior to the revolution and were very weak and didn't have much of a popular support. Some liberal parties that evolved after the revolution when they saw the political space opening up, and then the youth groups that actually were the spearhead of the revolution. So that group is basically found itself and its newfound power through the 18 days of the 25th of January revolution in 2011. And they became an important player on the scene, however, not at all organized and still did not have much of a grassroots operation to be able to, for instance, compete in elections right away and win. So essentially, what I'm going to argue today is that two out of those three groups need to ally together in order to have any sense of stability in Egypt. And whenever you got that sort of alliance, they were able to fight against the third. However, when in situations where the alliances broke down, you got a lot of instability. And so initially what we had, so first, before I go to what we had, the Salafi An-Nur party, which is the party that was allied with Muslim Brotherhood for the whole 2 years, or 2.5 years prior to the most recent military ouster of Morsi, actually jumped ship and joined the military. And that was clearly at the behest of the Saudis. The Saudis were very supportive of the military action against Morsi, against the Muslim Brotherhood. And the Salafis, even though they saw themselves really joining an essentially secular and nationalist coalition, they were the only Islamists who jumped ship in partly because of that influence of the Saudi on them. And the Saudis also, you know, supported the new regime with billions of dollars. Now, there were a number of centrist Islamist parties. These are primarily offshoots of the Muslim Brotherhood, but these were the moderates among the Muslim Brotherhood who did not like the hierarchical command and control format of the Brotherhood. The Brotherhood have a motto, or the principal motto is listen and obey. And these people, in fact, didn't want to listen and obey. So they were kind of moving closer to the secular revolutionary bloc during the 2.5 years of transition. But then as soon as the lines got drawn very clearly, the polarization lines after the ouster of Morsi, they rejoined the fold and became part of the Islamist bloc. So initially we had, I'm going to say also that the private news media is also in this kind of intermediate position where it was more aligned with the secularist revolutionary bloc for a good amount of time during 2.5 years, but then has completely taken the side of the state, so to speak, once the ouster occurred. So we had a first alliance between those two groups. It was clearly a tactical alliance against Mubarak. So during the 18 days, what destabilized the Mubarak regime is you had a very strong alliance between the revolutionaries. The Islamists were fairly late to come to that. However, by the second, third day of the uprisings, they realized what was going on and they jumped on the bandwagon, and they provided some of the muscle that fought the police forces during those few days, and as a result of that, kind of created themselves a space for themselves. But soon after, so this was January 25th to February 11th, 2011, where there was this solidarity. As soon as Mubarak left, they started recalculating. And the recalculation was, how do we are the most organized opposition on the scene. They were the only ones who were really much on the scene during the Mubarak regime as an opposition, and so they wanted to capitalize quickly by having elections organized as fast as possible. So in fact, they decided that the best thing would be to ally themselves with the military, which had taken over after Mubarak left, and put itself as the essentially the agent that's going to manage the transition until we get a democratically elected government. And the military, the reason it allied with the Islamists is because it basically said it's interested in stability. It wants to come back to stability as fast as possible. It wants to maintain its privileges and its autonomy vis-a-vis the civilian state as much as possible. And whoever is going to provide that quickly is who they're going to go with. And in fact, the military at that point also was very much influenced by U.S. policy, because a lot of these military officers are trained in the U.S. and are they realize that the U.S. is the main benefactor in terms of weapons, etc. And so at that point, the U.S. message was, get to stability, get to democratically elected governments as quickly as possible, and the Muslim Brotherhood are your best bet. And so there was then this potential alliance between the Brotherhood and the military, and it was the way it was operationalized is by having a transition plan which would specify that elections would happen first, and then the constitution writing and writing the new rules for the new system would happen much later, which was exactly what the secularists did not want, because they knew that if elections happened early on, the Islamists would win those elections, and then they would govern the writing of the constitution. And in fact, that's exactly what happened. However, the military had these very pragmatic reasons, and we will see very soon that this was, in fact, a misconception, because the Muslim Brotherhood was not about to share power with the military once it consolidated its power. So that alliance fell apart in mid or early 2012, once the Muslim Brotherhood won the parliamentary election, felt that it was starting to consolidate power, and soon after that, the military and the state apparatus in general and the Brotherhood were playing games about who was going to control whom. Now, so there was a period then between March 2012 and around early 2013, or even mid-2013, in which there were no alliances among these three groups. They were acting basically as independent poles, and the Brotherhood clearly wanted a quick transition to civilian rule because they thought that they were going to be able to control that process. But interestingly enough, the secularists and revolutionaries, because of their zeal for democracy at that point, wanted the military out. They did not want the process to happen the way it happened, but they wanted the military out, and so they tried to push very hard to get the military out of the game. And that created a kind of this unstable combination where the judiciary was trying to slow the advance of the Brotherhood. And they did that by nullifying the first parliament that was elected. The military then tried to, just a couple of weeks before the election of President Morsi in mid-2012, tried to put together a so-called soft coup where they put constitutional decrees that would limit his power, which as soon as he came into office, he did away with. But finally, what happened is that the Brotherhood, because of its attempt to basically overreach and take all power in its hands, pushed these two camps together. Initially, the secularist revolutionary bloc was very fragmented and very divided among itself. So the first thing that happened when the Brotherhood started to establish its dominance of the system is to push that bloc together in a cohesive front, and that was called the National Salvation Front. And then very soon, as they were organizing for the protests that led to the June 30 ouster of Morsi, they found that the natural allies would be the military and vice versa. So this is kind of how these alliances shifted, and I think at this point, so long as that alliance remains stable, they could continue as a stable arrangement, pushing the Brotherhood out, with of course the Brotherhood creating low-level problems, but will not create instability in the future. So the question is whether that alliance can remain stable over time, and that's what we can discuss in a few minutes. All right. So the main argument about the transition is that because of the military's interest in instability during 2011-2012, they were not interested in a long period of transition with a long debate over democratic constitution, etc. The architecture of the transition that they created was one that was clearly seen as being flawed. And in fact, it started to unravel, as I mentioned, in the middle of 2012. Now, the final thing was when the military itself had divisions within it, at least between the very top generals who had been there for a very long time, were quite old by military standards in terms of their retirement, and the second layer was actually really itching to move up. And so as a result of that division within the military, that's what Morsi was able to exploit in his first month in office, and basically managed to remove all the top brass, the five or six top officers, and promote General Sisi in the sense that he brought with him the rest of the younger officer corps. Now, so essentially, I want to kind of talk about what happened during the presidential election, because that gives you very clearly how these various alliances and how they shift. Essentially, we had a system where we had two rounds of election. The first round, you had as many candidates as wanted, and then with the two top candidates doing a runoff later. And if you looked at the opinion polls, and here are kind of the five top candidates, if you want. So you have Mohamed Morsi, who represents the Muslim Brotherhood, and who was the Muslim Brotherhood, I should say, had vowed not to run for presidential elections, because initially they knew that they had to signal at least that they were not overreaching, that they were going to try and kind of go slow in terms of their not to scare people off. But because of their the alliance falling apart between them and the military, they decided to put up a candidate, and that was Mohamed Morsi, who was their second choice, by the way. The first choice was eliminated due to technical reasons. The second guy, Ahmed Shafiq, is a clear representative of the old regime. He is of a military background. He used to be an Air Force general like Mubarak, and he was the last prime minister under the Mubarak regime. So the old regime and the Muslim Brotherhood had their standard bearers. And then the secular, kind of more moderate opposition had split their candidates across three people. And they couldn't agree on who would be the standard bearer. You know, you had Abu al-Futuh, who was a moderate Islamist, one of the guys who was a breakaway from the Brotherhood. You had Amr Musa, who was a former minister of foreign affairs and the head of the Arab League, who had departed sufficiently away from Mubarak to claim that he was part of the secular liberal front. And then Hamdin Sabahi, who was a socialist Nasserist candidate. Now, so you got that. Those are the votes that occurred in the first round. So you got basically the Brotherhood versus the old regime moving to the second round. 24.8% is about the sort of support that the Brotherhood is able to muster on its own. But so many of the liberal bloc, it was so anathema for them to vote for somebody from the old regime. For them, it would basically nullify the revolution. It would be essentially putting an X on the revolution, going back to Mubarak if they had voted for Shafiq. So essentially, they went and voted for Morsi. And so you get this kind of forced alliance between the seculars and the Islamists, So much of that vote, and even with that, he only got 51.7% of the vote. So you can see that the level of support for the Brotherhood is actually quite shallow, and probably an inch deep, and even though it seemed a little broad. Yeah.
Raggy, did a lot of people not vote in the second round?
I didn't, but, I couldn't. I mean, basically, a lot of people just could not vote, could not, you know, stomach either of these two guys. But at the same time, a lot of people who voted for the bottom three candidates actually went. But they also end up splitting across the two. You know, some of the diehard liberals said, we're going to go with a secularist, even if he's an old regime. And then some of those who are more. So in a sense, my point, though, is that if any one of those three had been second, he would have won the elections. Because he would have gotten all the old regime votes, plus some of the liberal and secular votes. So I think that so essentially you get a situation where the Brotherhood has a very small mandate, but overreaches dramatically after the elections. And if you look at the Muslim Brotherhood rule, starts to run into trouble essentially 5 months into Morsi's presidency. And that's 7 months before he was ousted. And on November 21st, 2012, he uses his, since there's no constitution yet, he uses his authority as president to come up with what's called constitutional decrees, which is a tool that the military had used before in the previous 2 years. But his constitutional decrees of November 21st basically said, I'm above any ruling by the courts. No court ruling will apply to my decrees. And by that, he essentially managed to completely protect the Constituent Assembly, the Islamist-dominated Constituent Assembly that was writing the Constitution, from any court challenge, as well as the upper house of parliament, which was also Islamist-dominated and was still sitting at that point.
I was just curious where the Salafists fell in the first round of the elections there. Were they with the moderate Islamists to oppose the Brotherhood?
The Salafists were split. They actually partly went to the moderate Islamists and partly went with the Muslim Brotherhood. They didn't have a candidate. Their own candidate, in fact, had been disqualified because, this is an interesting story, they discovered that his mother had gotten American citizenship. And according to the rules, neither of your parents could be foreign, and was disqualified on that basis. So it's an interesting point. So by basically essentially putting himself above the law or above the rule of the courts, and kind of taking over this kind of semi-dictatorial power, he managed to really galvanize the opposition. So the secular opposition got together. The army at that point stayed in the sidelines, and judiciary, in fact, was up in arms against him. And there was started kind of this confrontation between the judiciary and the Muslim Brotherhood regime, including having the Islamists physically surround the Supreme Court building and not allowing the judges in. I mean, it got to a point of actually severe street confrontation. Now, the military at this point started to signal discomfort, but very subtly. So they would say, President Sisi would like to invite everybody to get together to start talking about reconciliation. Did I say President Sisi? No. Defense Minister Sisi. So that's a slip here. So, of course, the Brotherhood reacted very badly to this attempt by the defense minister at that point to try and be the mediator, but it was the beginning of the dissatisfaction of the. Now, followed by that was basically several months, or you know, mostly a year, but several months since November, of just one economic and diplomatic misstep after the other. The first was the huge brouhaha around the building of the Renaissance Dam on the Blue Nile in Ethiopia. And for Egypt, that was a very sensitive issue because 80% of the Nile waters come from the Blue Nile. And if Ethiopia builds the dam there, and of course there was, and the Morsi was blamed for basically not handling this diplomatically in a proper way, and basically not developing the relationship with Ethiopia and creating a state of conflict. And the military in particular, this for them was a national security issue. So that's, you also had inability to reach a deal with the IMF, because the IMF demanded some very mild conditions about reducing the budget deficit by a certain amount, which were actually, by IMF standards, were very, very easy conditions. But because of the turmoil, the Brotherhood could not deal with that. So you basically had an economic hemorrhage with the foreign reserves declining dramatically, etc. We started having electricity and fuel shortages, and some people suspect this was the elements of the deep state sabotaging the Muslim Brotherhood regime, although it's probably not all that, but some of it may be that. And then finally, in terms of the where the military really loses faith in Morsi's leadership, is the deteriorating security situation in the Sinai. Basically, essentially a jihadi sort of Qaeda-led low-intensity conflict was beginning in the Sinai with tremendous security implications for Egypt. And the military felt that is particularly... And they, as they tried to control what was happening, Morsi actually held them back because he said, those are Muslims and we shouldn't be fighting with other Muslims, etc. So this created the seeds of the break between the military and the Brotherhood regime. Now, in the meantime, the civilian population was turning rapidly against the Muslim Brotherhood, very, very strongly. And you could see, I was in Egypt, in December originally, December and January, and then later on in May, and the difference in the sentiment against the Brotherhood over this very short period of time was incredible. And so this group of young people, basically the revolutionaries that were, in a sense, lost in the wilderness during that transition period, found their mission again, and they started creating this petition campaign. So this group essentially started with five people getting a petition, and they said, we're going to get 15 million signatures in a month, in a matter of a couple of months by June 30th. And June 30th was the end of the first year of Morsi's presidency. And so they it was a symbolic date at that point. And in fact, that petition, which is not online, paper petition that people have to sign, put their identity card on, put their address, they got 22 million people to sign in a month and a half. So it was, you know, clearly you could see that the petition was basically a recall campaign. They wanted Morsi out. And while there's no legal basis, there was no constitution even, or at least there was a constitution that was passed in the darkness of night against everybody's, against the opposition's wishes. But there was no constitutional principle for recall, but still the fact that they got. And they said, we want everybody to come out on June 30th to a demonstration. Now, the June 30th demonstration is probably one of the largest gathering of people in the history of the world. There were millions. I mean, people say 13 million. Even if they were in the single digits of millions, they were huge all over the country. Now, it's as a result of that then the military said, okay, now we're going to come in.
Sorry, just for a little perspective, what is approximately the population of Egypt?
Egypt is 85 million people. Okay. And so if you get 22 million, that's a good fraction of the adult population.
Yeah, so half
must
be killed.
Yes.
The only other question, so were these signatures mostly collected in Alexandria and Cairo, or are they all over the country?
All over the country. they managed to really get this grassroots operation to spread all over the country. And that's why the June 30th demonstration were not just in Cairo and Alexandria, but they were all over, mostly urban centers, I mean, the people. So essentially, the military, which was already was itching and had lost faith in this regime, decided, okay, if we let this confrontation go on, we're going to have tremendous violence down the road, because these people were not about to leave the streets until Morsi leaves. And so they decided, and they may have jumped the gun, but they decided to basically give a 48-hour ultimatum to Morsi and tell him, you announce an early election, or you announce a referendum about your rule, or we intervene. And of course, he didn't agree, and they intervened, and the rest you've heard much about. So the question is this a military-backed second wave of the revolution, as most Egyptians like to think of it, or is it a popularly supported military coup? I mean, if it is a military coup, it clearly has tremendous popular support. And so the question is, we had this unprecedented campaign, we had the huge demonstrations. Right now, opinion polls as they are, they're not very accurate, show that about there is 70 to 80% support to the military right now in Egypt. The military was a bit more clever this time about their transition. They didn't create a military junta and said, we are the presidency now. They appointed the head of the Supreme Court as a temporary president. They appointed an extremely competent civilian cabinet to run the affairs of the country. And right now, the defense secretary is only a defense minister and a deputy minister for national security affairs. Deputy prime minister for national security affairs. So he's not, at least formally, giving himself huge power. But of course, he has gained tremendous popularity as the kind of leader of this coup. And I am convinced right now that he will take off his uniform, will run for election in the next presidential election, and will probably win by a good landslide. And that is because of that popular support that he has. So what are my concerns? Well, my concerns are that we are, to some extent, with popular support, recreating an authoritarian repressive state. Whether this is a temporary phase until the confrontation with the Brotherhood is kind of reduced, or this is going to be something that the military is going to basically use the excuse of continued instability and continued violence on the part of the Islamists to reestablish the authoritarian police state. This is really a question mark, and I'm much more worried about it than many of my friends and relatives who see it as a necessary evil in some sense at this point. Now, I also see a problem in there's a certain lack of credible alternative civilian leadership. At one point, we all had our hopes on Mohammed al-Baradei, who was the former director of the International Atomic Energy Agency, a Nobel Prize winner, somebody with tremendous external credibility. He was the deputy prime minister in the civilian transition government. But then when the military decided to crack down on the Brotherhood and killed several hundred of them as they were dispersing the Syrians, he resigned. And as a result, I think, given the popular support for the military, has taken himself out of the running for political leadership in Egypt for a while. Yeah.
Actually, could you talk a little bit more about the reaction to the deaths of people? Because I think a lot of people are taken aback by the severity of the force used to disperse the people of the city. And it seems to me that's an issue, because that's affected, I think, a lot of perceptions about what's going on.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question that, you know, a lot of Egyptians are saying that this is tragic, that this had to happen. But many of them blame the Brotherhood for forcing the situation because they wanted to create martyrs, so that the martyrdom can then take the fight forward. So, in fact, they were provided 6 weeks' worth of warning that this is going to happen. The Egyptian police, and this was done by the police rather than the military, is simply not well trained to deal with demonstrators. They don't know how to deal with demonstrators in effectively in nonviolent, and they've shown that in every single stage of this revolution. And so violence by the police is almost automatic. People were shocked, but at the same time, a lot of people believe that the Brotherhood instigated some of the violence. For instance, they started shooting so that the police shoots back. Or that they put, in fact, there's a lot of people who actually believe that. I don't necessarily subscribe to it, that the Brotherhood had sharpshooters on these buildings to shoot on the crowd to make it look like the police was shooting on the crowd. So it seemed to me that the rational response on the part of the police is to do this as non-violently as possible. But they simply didn't know how to. I mean, I think that's the... But there was definitely the sense on the part of the regime and the population that this had to stop, that they couldn't go on forever. I personally thought, why didn't they just surround the city and let them be? But, yeah.
Can you say something about factions within the military and how united or divided it appears to be?
Currently, the military looks to be very cohesive. And the Brotherhood did not, while they were hoping that they could find a faction of their own within the military, they in fact, and a lot of people were worried that maybe the lower ranks are more sympathetic to the Brotherhood, etc. That appears to hasn't materialized. And it hasn't materialized possibly because of they know that they would be in deep trouble if they showed any kind of division, or because the military over the years had been very careful in excluding anybody with Islamist tendencies from the officer corps. So there was like a litmus test. And that was part of the Mubarak regime's kind of way of protecting the security forces and the military from the Islamists.
How is the military treating the Brotherhood leadership currently?
Currently, most of the Brotherhood leadership is imprisoned, so they are behind bars. And they are essentially going to be tried for crimes such as inciting violence, such as, because there was a big, once the protest or the sit-in was dispersed, there was a huge spasm of violence. And there is evidence that the Brotherhood actually incited that violence, both against Christians and against police and military. So right now they are going through, but they're being charged with these crimes and they're going through the judicial process, essentially. Okay, so let's talk about the U.S. And this, I think, if you remember, the two arrows that were had no clue in that very first was what the U.S. should do about Egypt. Now, both sides perceive the U.S. to be on the opposite side. So it basically has no friends right now. So the military perceives, the military and the secularists perceive the U.S. to have supported the Islamists. And there are all kinds of plot theories that are flying around in Egypt. But essentially, I think the main idea here is that the U.S. and an ambassador in Egypt in particular was very keen on seeing a successful Islamist democracy. And they saw this as Turkey number two. If it can work in Turkey, why couldn't it work in Egypt? What they didn't realize was that the Brotherhood is very different from the Turkish Islamist parties. Brotherhood is a highly non-democratic, hierarchical, militant organization that has a history of basically using democracy as a tool, as an instrument to reach power, but really had no interest in democracy for its own sake. And so I think this faith in the Brotherhood as a democratic, as a leadership of a democratic process in Egypt was really misplaced. So, and of course, on the other side, the fact that the U.S. has not cut off
Egypt completely and cut off aid to the military, etc. They see this as a betrayal, and they see the U.S. as siding with the other side. Now, so right now we have a complete lack of trust in U.S. intentions. And in fact, Egyptians right now, although they are horrified about what's happening in Syria, are very opposed to any U.S. intervention in Syria, for example, or any U.S. intervention anywhere in the Middle East because of this lack of trust. And the lack of trust is complemented by a whole bunch of plot theory scenarios, for example, that President Obama paid the Brotherhood $8 billion to cede 40% of the Sinai to Hamas, so that Hamas can create a Palestinian state in the Sinai. This is a widely held, very funny if you understand the American political system, but widely held belief. The other thing is now all of a sudden they discovered a few U.S. Congress people who are very supportive of the Egyptian military and anti-Brotherhood. Guess who? Michelle Bachmann. So Michelle Bachmann is the new American hero in Egypt. And of course, I hear that and I say, what is going on? She was just in Egypt 2 days ago showing how the Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda are the same thing, and we were victims of terrorism in 9/11, as you are victims of terrorism now, and she was kind of, this was just a couple of days ago. So,
I think she's called the military comparable to George Washington.
Yes, she did call the military comparable to George Washington. But I think the end result is that currently the U.S. has significantly reduced leverage in Egypt. Their potential leverage over the military, because they control the military budget and the weaponry, etc., has been eroded considerably by the fact that the military is now able to get aid from Saudi Arabia and Kuwait in large amounts that is well beyond what they get from the U.S. Of course, the source of, the military is going to care whether the weapons themselves and the spare parts, etc., get cut off. But still, it's fairly limited leverage because there is this wave of nationalism that is anti-U.S. at this point. Now, so my sense is the best thing the U.S. could do about Egypt right now is nothing. It's simply let Egyptians figure it out and not try to intervene at this point. Okay, so prospects for the future. I'm going to go pretty quickly because I want to leave some time for questions. I mean, I do think that the military is going to be the arbiter of political developments in Egypt for a while, even if it appears to be from the sidelines or from behind the scenes. They may have, and they seem to be moving fairly quickly towards a transition to a democratic regime, except it's going to be one that provides very limited role for the Islamists. So excluding the Islamists is likely going to create violence, ongoing low-intensity conflict on the part of the Islamists. It's not going to be anywhere near what the level in Syria or in Libya, or because there is a very cohesive coalition against them. However, it is going to be an excuse for continued emergency rule and suspension of the rule of law, which I think over the long run is very corrosive. And I think that essentially the only hope that I have is that this revolution did create a very engaged citizenry. People are all talking about politics, very engaged, and they're going to realize very quickly that they're not going to allow the revolution to be stolen back. So hopefully they will put some limits on the military's power. So I'll stop here.
That's terrific. Right, let's have some more questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was really enlightening. But I have a question. Where do you place yourself within these three spheres? And with an academic given the same lecture and narrative, how would it differ?
Yeah, I have to be very honest. I place myself in the lower left-hand corner with the secularist and liberal crowd, for sure. However, I'm currently in disagreement with a number of people in my same box who feel that
it is worth paying the cost of allying with the military to basically suppress the Brotherhood. So I'm actually one of the few people who is supporting Mohammed al-Baradai and his position of the rule of law and human rights have to be maintained, even when you're fighting a very dedicated organization that wants to control power. Now, of course, you're going to get a somewhat different lecture if you had somebody from an Islamist camp providing that. And I don't claim that academics need to be fully objective. You have to show where you're coming from, and you basically argue from that position. While being true to your principles, but to claim that I can take on the hat of an Islamist, that's not a position that I believe in.
Syria. Mm-hmm. Syria. What's the...
Well, I should say there is a panel tomorrow, by the way, at 4 o'clock. I mean, I think Syria, to me, is the example of what happens when you let a conflict fester and to the point where there are no good answers. I was in a position that very early on, after the Syrian revolution started and the regime started suppressing the population and killing thousands of people, that there should have been a limited action to create a no-fly zone, similar to what protected the Kurds in the 90s. I'm talking about the Kurds in the 90s, not what happened after 2003. That was a relatively low-cost operation that was able to be established fairly quickly, and that leveled the playing field between Assad and his opponents. Now, at that time, most of the opposition was still the nationalist Free Syrian Army, not the jihadis who came from all over the world seeing Syria as the new jihad. So I think waiting for this to happen and to get all these Qaeda people and jihadi people to arrive this and make this their cause has created an incredibly incendiary mix. I don't see anything good, you know, happening in Syria. Even if Assad falls tomorrow, there's going to be a huge problem in Syria as these different factions within the oppositions fight each other.
What should Obama do?
Right now? Take on the Russian offer as quickly as possible.
Do you want to say something about the talk tomorrow?
I have the advertisement.
Ah, here it is.
So tomorrow it's called Countering Mass Atrocities in Syria Between Human Rights Ideals and Geopolitical Concerns, a panel discussion featuring around Jim Rohn and Raghi Assad, as well as Ron Krebs from Political Science and members of the Syrian
and Sarah
community.
Parkinson.
Oh, wonderful. Sarah will be on it as well. Wednesday, September 11th, that's tomorrow, 4 p.m., room 125 of Willie Hall. Willie 125. It's moderated by Barb Fry.
I'm just curious about how the military decision makers think right now, because in a way, their decision around the revolution initially actually had a big impact, because they did not intervene in a way that would have stifled the growing change efforts. They made a calculation. You've suggested that in part it was because they didn't like what they saw coming after Mubarak. Now, how do you think their decision-making process works out?
I mean, I think this is the big question.
And what can the secularists do about that?
At this point, I do still think they are very much oriented towards wanting stability. But right now, their calculation is stability is not going to come from the Islamists. That was a big miscalculation. Stability is going to come from basically reestablishing the parts of the old state and aligning with the secularist and the revolutionary youth. However, if the revolutionary youth start to become uppity and they start to object, then who knows how their calculus would change. But I do believe that the military is not interested anymore in direct rule, and that they remain in power themselves. They want to be able to have a civilian government that doesn't basically interfere in their affairs. What their ideal is to have a couple of items in the Constitution saying military budget is one line item in the budget, one number, and we have a National Security Council which is nominated by the military that decides how to spend it, and basically all decisions about military promotions, etc., happen in this National Security Council, which has considerable military influence and control. And then they can maintain their economic prerogatives. So for them, that's the ideal world, and they let the civilians deal with running the messy day-to-day rule of the country, which they have been burnt with and don't want to be able to be in it. So however they're going to get that, they're going to try to get that. I mean, and they're going to try to get some civilian in power.
But in that calculation, how do you address issues of poverty alleviation and the sort of the general oppression that people feel? Because if they hands off and let the other people run, then it seems to me that the consequences for the individual person on the street is left at will, and that's a large part of the rising of the secular youth, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I think what they are happy to leave enough decision-making and leeway to the civilians to figure out. I mean, right now they know a big demand of the revolution is social equity. And that the people are not going to give up on that demand. They're not going to allow the cronies that Mubarak had basically to suck up all the benefits to the very top. So I think there is enough sense about the military, and they weren't happy about the cronyism around the Mubarak regime. So they have a sense that there has to be enough social equity and enough nationalist developmentalist strategy taking place in the country, but they don't want to do it themselves, is what I'm saying. So they're going to allow competent civilians to do it. And in fact, right now, the cabinet in power right now is among the most competent cabinets Egypt has ever had. And whether they're going to be able to do their job or not because of the security situation is the big question mark. Yeah, over the back.
When I was looking at your election figures, showing the percentages, it occurred to me that if Egypt had an instant runoff voting, the liberal secularists would have won.
I think you're right.
I could be.
I think you're absolutely right.
Sarah had a question.
Yeah, Sarah, and then I'll go back to you.
So I had a quick question about the idea of poverty alleviation and, you know, social equity more generally, which is the Islamic parties, and particularly the Muslim Brotherhood, are traditionally the organizations that have had the most capacity in these areas and that have been active in areas like Mbaba, for example. So what is it going to take for a new government or an emerging new government, even if they're the most competent people in the world, to be able to establish the type of grassroots networks that it would take to actually be engaged with these communities?
Yeah, it's interesting because the Islamic parties, the Salafis and the Muslim Brotherhood, have a very charity-oriented form of poverty alleviation. So basically, they're not about creating jobs or about, they are about giving money to the poor. And I think a lot of the Egyptians, once they got power and had 12 months of rule, people saw that their economic policies were just as neoliberal as the Mubarak economic policies in terms of job creation, in terms of investments, in terms of the cronies and all kind of stuff. So I think this kind of this kind of reputation that they are the ones who care for the poor has kind of been removed a little bit. But you're right. There's going to have to be, on the part of whatever civilian government takes over, a determined attempt to reach those grassroots economically and have a more equitable economic development. Otherwise, they're going to have all of this happening again.
Time for probably just about 1 minute.
There's one over there.
Yeah.
Where?
Okay. Mine is pretty quick, I think.
Okay, go ahead.
I was just curious, when you said the U.S. should not do anything and let it work itself out, did you kind of mean maintaining the status quo of aid, military aid that we've been getting, or cut it?
No, actually, cutting is doing something.
Yeah, that's... Okay.
Right, so I think maintaining the status quo is the way to go. And
But basically, cutting it would be a direct action that would be considered to be very hostile, given that this aid has been going on for 30 years.
One quick question. When the Arab Spring first occurred, the Western media was very, you know, I guess behind it, thinking this is a great type of situation. Western style democracy will flourish, et cetera, et cetera. As like Egypt has fallen back into disorder, maybe Libya a little bit, and now, what is your opinion on the Arab Spring? Is it an overall positive movement for the Middle East? Is Western style democracy a viable choice in the Middle East? Or is there a cultural difference that our style democracy, our traditional democracy, will not function in that part of the world?
You should be able to handle that.
But I'm still very bullish and positive on the Arab Spring. So I do think that the Middle East is not an exception to this transition to democracy. I do think that the pathways are very different. It's not Eastern Europe. It's not Latin America. They're going to have to find their own pathways, and I think it's going to take longer for people to learn the game of democracy. But I think, despite the ups and downs, I think it's a progressive and very important stage of history within the region.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you all for coming. In 2 weeks' time, something completely different. Miles Shaver from the Strategic Management Department of the B School is going to be talking about why we have so many multinational corporations headquartered here in the Twin Cities. So hope you'll come and join us.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Of course.
Thank you.